Look, can you see that it's like, can you see?
What am I looking for?
One is, this is much than this one. You can see it by the, maybe not on the camera, nonetheless. Hello everybody and welcome to WineText TV, brought to you by WineText.com. America's number one way to buy wine, according to my mother. We're here and we are focused on Pinot Noir today. We've got four really well-known and or high-end Pinots, so we're upticking it a little bit for episode, what is this, episode four? It's episode four of WineText TV. I'm here with Brandon Warnicki, Matt Toro from Wine Libraries in the background as well. Let's get right into it. Not much to talk about. Please leave, actually we're answering questions. So thank you everybody. If you're watching this on social or on YouTube, make sure you ask questions. And as always, big shout out to Twitch, twitch.tv/GaryVee. Come and subscribe. Always is in the background live on the show. First wine of the episode, the La Crema 2022 Sonoma Coast Pinot. I wanted to do this wine on the show because it's incredibly popular. I see this on lots of people's tables at plenty of restaurants. I'm aware because I look at Wine Library stores numbers and this sells. I'm also super thrilled for La Crema, a winery I grew up with. Unlike all three of these wines, this was a brand that really, and when I say grew up with, from the time I was 14, this is a brand I knew. Back then, their Pinot and Chardonnay were $9.99. Inflation and popularity has kicked in. They're now $28 on suggested retail. And let's give it a sniffy sniff. Classic nose. What I mean by that is with Pinots, they're always gonna have, you know, when you've smelled 43,819 Pinot Noirs like I have, that might be what I'm referring to. And what I mean by that is, this is just like a traditional Pinot Noir nose, good little red fruit, a little, I've always find that with the reason I can pick a Pinot, if I was to blind smell it and be like, what kind of wine is this? The way my brain translates what I smell is like, I call it like pig fat. And I know that's like a weird thing to like bring up, but kind of like the fatty oils of like French food is what comes through on the nose. Pork rind. Like, you know, that burnt kind of thing going on a little bit. So, good little nose. Let's give it a whirl. Good medium body. You know, look, this is a supermarket wine. This is at Wine Library and at BevMo and at Specs and at Binny's. Like, this is something you can all find. And a lot of these wines are heavily overrated and overpriced. Look, this is a wine that suggested $28. You could probably find it pretty easily in certain parts of America under 20 or right about, let's call it 17 to 24 is my intuition on knowing the market a little bit. And it's not bad. I'm gonna be very transparent. Probably my subconscious, because I grew up with this wine, and again, remembered it as a $9.99 wine, because I wanna be transparent. Walk into broad market products with a little more cynicism than I will with a small boutique wine. It's just kind of like the wine nerd thing we do. And I have always done a pretty good job when I did Wine Library TV back in the day, those 1,000 episodes, to try to leave that at the door, which I'm doing here, which is why I'm going where I'm going. To me, this is like an 89 plus point wine. This is very solid. I'm a little bit surprised in a great way. Good job by La Crema. Really solid Pinot Noir. I like it. Thoughts?
I agree, and there's a reason why it sells so much and it's so popular, obviously.
Yeah.
I think the style is similar, you know, most vintages. In fact, I think last year, this is one of the top values from the Spectator, so just very good, solid.
Yeah, it's really nice.
And smooth. You're right on track with that range in pricing, 18 to 24, like that's exactly.
Well, I do talk to you 14 exactly times a day, every day, so I'm keeping on top of stuff. All right, let's keep it going. Four Graces Willamette Valley Pinot Noir 2022. 91 points Wine Spectator, 90 points Wine Enthusiast, $35 suggested retail. Let's give you a little glass, Brandon. Give me another glass. Let's keep Matty Toro shouldn't be left out, just sitting there looking at us.
Appreciate it.
Of course. Brandon, this wine's gotten pretty hot. I asked you as we were thinking about the Pinot Noir show. Talk to me about some wines that are out there that are hot, that like everybody can find.
Yep.
Towards the tail end of my day-to-day wine career, this wine started to get a little buzzy. Yep. Talk to me about what's been going on with it.
So I think number one, it's Willamette, right? And so, well, it's always been an area maybe a little tricky to find value under $20. I remember A to Z, like that forever was like the big one. And it's still apparent today, but Four Graces has taken off. This is their entry level. They have several others as well. But when it comes to Oregon, when it comes to Willamette, this is what it is.
And for everybody who's watching, when you think about Pinot Noir in the world, Burgundy is like, French Burgundy is like way, way, way up here. And then you have a really interesting kind of, from that place, debate, right? Oregon, in the United States, by many people's wine nerdom, is the place where we make the best Pinot Noir. There's also an incredible debate, and a very valid one, and even, and I ebb and flow, depending on the winery, that Sonoma is the place that we make Russian River and other parts of that. Then there's an argument that I've always had back in the way day that Central Otago in New Zealand was another place that could rival for best Pinot Noirs after Burgundy. Those are kind of the front runners, but there's good Pinot Noir being made everywhere. I've been really surprised in my journey as like someone who just drinks wine now that's not fully professionally in. Alsatian Pinot Noir from France, I think is underpriced. Loire Valley Pinot Noir is a sneaky player. There's even been, you know, Pinots my brain just kicked in. I would argue that Casablanca, Chile, makes some of the great Pinot Noirs in the world. And so Casablanca, Chile, Central Otago, New Zealand, these are places. And then you've got Vancouver, the Okanagan. Believe it or not, Canadian Pinot Noir from Okanagan, which kind of touches on the Oregon from a, you know, if you know the geography, kind of touches on that terroir and climate. And there's some real serious wines coming out of there, though incredibly under-marketed and unknown. And I don't expect many Americans even ever having an Okanagan Pinot Noir if they don't go to Vancouver to vacation. All right, let's refocus on Willamette Valley one more time to remind you. Four Graces, very popular, $35 SRP, again, which that means 25 to 35, depending on where you're finding it. Closed nose compared to the La Crema, much, much more of a closed nose. I'm getting far less aromatics. Now, it's young for a more serious wine, but for me, there's a little bit of cranberry here, but aromatically, it's not as strong as La Crema. Now, that also means that it may need a little bit more aging, could use more decanting. This is a little bit of a pop and pour. So just because the nose isn't as good at first for you at home, some of these wines, especially when they start getting into $30 and above, they're kind of wines that can really use a couple of hours of breathing. One of my favorite day-to-day hacks about wine is if you buy wine that's $30 or more and you plan on drinking it on a Tuesday or a Friday or a Sunday night, open that wine. If you don't have a decanter, just open that wine and let it sit on your kitchen counter starting at, on a weekend, noon. Let it sit there for 7-8 hours. Or believe it or not, even on a Tuesday night, before you go to work, literally pop it at 9 a.m., 8 to 8 a.m. in the morning and have it later that night. The air will be your friend. It will break up those tannins, a lot of the bitterness a lot of you struggle with red wine, and you will like it more. That is my quick interpretation of what's happening here. This hasn't been open very long, and on the pop and pour, the nose is limited, but that might not be the final verdict. It might just be that it's not airing enough right now. Let's give it a whirl. What do you got on the question? Let's sneak a question in.
It's actually on the same lines. I'm a wine writer and would love your take on wine scores. You use them a lot here, but it seems like the younger generation don't like them at all. How important and influential are wine scores?
I wouldn't say the younger generation doesn't like them. You look at 21 to 30 year old shopping, they like to talk big game because they're so Gen Z'd and millennialed out and they're too cool for school. But I see them at Whole Foods looking at the little score and grabbing the one that has a 91 on it. So I think there's a little bit more talk to like fight the system, and then there's the reality. And so I think they say they don't like them as much, but they're buying because of them just as much as the 40 and 50 year olds. Wine scores are completely subjective. Please zoom in on Brandon's shirt. Brandon likes that shirt, he's wearing it. I, on the other hand, think it's solid. I don't want to razz him because he's my guy. I don't like it as much. He may think my hat is stupid. He's wearing a Fruit Bomb throwback Wine Library TV shirt. Carly's super, super glammed out like a youngster with her stuff, but somebody might think that's too loud. I think it's awesome. It's beauty in the eye of the beholder. Wine scores are subjective. What you want to find is you want to go and taste 10 to 12 wines from, like, if you're really into wine, my recommendation is buy a case of wine from the same critic once a month. Month of January, buy all Jed Dunnick scored 90 point wines. Month number two, buy all Gary V from WineText TV's favorite wines. Month number three, Lisa Peretti Brown. D, wine enthusiast. E, wine spectator. F, Luca Moroni. Z, all the way through, right? Advocate, Vinus, wine enthusiast. This has scored 97 points. California wine.
Advisors.
No, but there's a lot of small things. Plus, there's bloggers. There's Andre Mack out there. Big shout out to my buddy. There's personalities. But take a month or two or go on a journey where you really pay attention. Is Wine Advocate for you? Is Wine Spectator for you? Is Decanter for you? Is Gary V for you? Like, find someone who you agree with enough times that that becomes your go-to. So what do I think about wine scores? They're subjective. And there's people out there, James Suckling, there's people out there that are consistent. That's what I'm proud of. I was so scared to rate something poorly or well, and then be at a party and somebody say, what do you think about this? And then give a different answer, that I was scared to ever review a wine on anything other than how I feel about it. That made me consistent. You consistently got what I cared about. No politics, no giving a crap about anything, but being right about, for my palate. And then there's people who agree with my palate, and they could be, I could be a source for them. And then there's people that don't like the styles that I like, and I could be like a reverse source of them. If you think, like, I like wines that are too earthy and vegetal, which I do. So I love Chinon from Loire Valley. Well, then you should know that I like earthy, dirty, vegetal wines with a good fruit undertone. And that if I'm scoring something as too fruit bomby, like this wine. Honestly, this wine I think is just okay. I'm not in love with this wine. It's a very popular wine. There's a lot of people that love. Oh, Maddie jumping in, right? Very popular. I don't see why. To me, this wine, what do we sell this for?
Just under 20.
It's $18.99 on the show.
Oh, so why'd you put $35 SRP?
That's the SRP.
Now, right away, notice how my demeanor changed. Well, listen, it's half fucking price. Beep that effing. Now I'm a little bit more optimistic because price does, you know, factor into how you feel. I still think it's okay. I think it's a little bit one-dimensional. The mid palate's very disjointed, in my opinion. And the finish is kind of like just okay. So ironically, this makes me feel better about the wine. At 35, I'm like, this is insane. This is a bad deal. At 16 to 22, in pocket, there's plenty of Pinots like this. But that goes to being very popular. That goes down to marketing and good ratings. I can promise you right now, money in the bank, 15 to 25, 15 to 22, $18.99 you said?
Yep.
Right, $18.99, there's 53 $18.99 Pinot Noirs that are as good as this wine that I can think of off the top of my head, and I promise you start to go to Australian, Chile, and New Zealand, you'll find a ton of them. And, you know, so it's fine. And again, I think I can buy a Bourgogne Rouge from a good Burgundy producer for $21.99. That's $3 more a bottle than this. That will smoke it from a top producer. So I'm not with Wine Enthusiast and Wine Spectator on a 91 and 90, but I'm not too far off. I'm going to go 87 plus on this. Solid Pinot, but it'd be a pass for me. Though 18 bucks doesn't scare me. And it's more than enough for a nice little glass of wine at the airport. Let's move on. What do we got here, Ben?
That's the Lingua Franca, I think, right? The Amity Hills?
Yep.
Lingua Franca.
Yep. Lingua Franca from Willamette as well. Single vineyard. Great scores. 95 points. Jed Dunnick? Mm-hmm. That's a huge score. 94 Spectator. Mm-hmm. 94 Vinus. Winemaker, Toro.
He worked at Dujac, Romani Conti. Spent some time at some other top Burgundy producers. Like those are big time producers.
Big time producers. And I think that's where I get excited sometimes with Oregon, because the climate is more similar to Burgundy than Sonoma. When I hear assistant winemakers or winemakers from Burgundy come over to do projects in Oregon, I get excited. I've historically always loved those wines. Even in the mid-90s, I remember the 94 Oregon Pinot Noir vintage. Look up the vintage chart, I promise you it's a good one. I had a lot of Domaine Druin and some of that kind of stuff when they were first coming up the scene. I'm excited about tasting this wine. Brandon, what is this going for? $49.99?
Yep.
So suggested retail 60, we sell for $49.99. Is that in pocket to what it's selling for? So $50 wine, expensive stuff, Dust. This is like you're going on a big date trying to impress your girl, Dustin. You impress her with $50 Pinot Noirs?
Where's she?
You impress her with your charm?
She likes house wine, that brand. It's like a can.
Yeah.
So she likes.
Beauty in the eye of the beholder.
Exactly.
I got to stay
consistent.
Drink what you like. Sniffy sniff. This is a great nose. Wow, this is beautiful. Very creamy, floral, rose petal, beautiful black fruit, which I always appreciate in Pinot Noir because I get a lot of strawberries more often, but when I get a little hint of that blueberry, which if you've ever seen my most viral clip, put it up here right here.
I eat blueberries like it's my job.
I love blueberries. Post-production, please. Great blueberries, great red. Whenever I get red and black fruit mixed in a nose, I get excited. If it smells like a blueberry and cherry pie mix, I get excited because I'm getting the dark and the red fruit, and that's what I'm getting on this nose, along with very exciting notes of like rose petal, but then also, I always think of Wimbledon. They always talk about strawberries and cream. Whenever I get that creamy nose, I would call it like half and half. When it smells milky to me, I get excited. It's good. This is extremely Burgundian. What I mean by that is now we're getting into my territory. Give me a little dirt. Give me a little stinky sock. Give me a little sour. I've got a little pickle juice. Like, this is complex. This has other things going on. The first wine, La Crema, joyful, but it's like, it's kind of like having a lot of makeup on. Not because it looks pretty, but like deep down, is it really pretty? This wine has just crazy character. This is all personality, if we're kind of making the analogy of people. Very complex, very dry, very, very, very I'm so rusty-ish that in a blind tasting, this could trick me. Like in a double blind, I could get seduced into thinking this is like a little bit more in a Burgundian style. And so I love that. Medium bodied, not too heavy. Some of the great Sonoma, California Pinot Noirs, the Costa Browns, the Sea Smokes, the stuff that people are hot on right now. Sometimes they get a little too heavy. It's like Pinot making pretend it's Cabernet. A little too heavy on the body. Not this. This has got that perfect Pinot style. Elegance out the yang. This is good wine. You like it?
Yeah, yeah.
You like this too?
Yeah.
Your style?
Has great acidity too.
Great acidity. This is really well made. And what the acidity and the dryness does is like where I'm really getting excited is now I'm like, oh, I can pair this with a, like, I like pigeon. I like birds and like I love like French cuisine, even though it's like I eat cleaner and lighter more often, but like I'm thrilled for once or twice a month going like foie gras city and escargot and like pheasant and like sauces and like give me a fucking 3-star Michelin like life. And so this is that kind of wine. This is a beautiful wine. I'm gonna go 94 points as well. I'm right in pocket with everyone. This is really well made stuff. And honestly, a super value at $49.99. This is the kind of Pinot Noir that I would spend $90 for in Burgundy and be thrilled. So good value. Bevan. 2021 Petaluma Gap Pinot Noir from Sonoma Coast, 97 points, California wine.
Advisors.
I like that one. 94 points, Lisa Peretti Brown.
Yep.
Who used to be the editor-in-chief of Wine Advocate after Robert Parker.
Yep.
Who's got her own thing now.
Yep.
Which is called what again?
It's called Wine Independent.
The Wine Independent. I like her scores. I like her. I think she's a good critic.
Yeah, she's there for quite a while, and now she's got her.
What's this selling for?
That's it's 80 bucks. 80 bucks straight.
80 bucks straight, yeah, from everywhere?
Yes.
All right, 80 bucks. This is, you gotta make money like Sid to be able to afford this, Dust. This is big boy. And right away, there we go. Sorry, I don't have the lighting for this. Actually, here we go. Dust, do your best here. Mm-hmm. I'm gonna show you what I was talking about with California. Look. Can you see that it's like, can you see?
What am I looking for?
One is, this is much thicker and darker than this one.
Oh.
Mm-hmm. You can see it by the, maybe not on the camera. Nonetheless, here we go with what sometimes good, sometimes bad, but like this is big boy Pinot. Let's give it a sniffy sniff. Nice nose, very aromatically exciting, kind of like a more refined, exciting version of what I just smelled with the La Crema. You could see the pedigree difference right away. Bevan is a winery that was getting ripping hot as I was towards the tail end of my day-to-day wine career. Big shout out to Ian Doran, I know, who loved Bevan and they had a nice relationship, right? He used to be a wine guy at the wine library. They've made a lot of remarkable wines and was a super favorite of all the critics, right? Always big scores for the years, Brandon?
Yep.
big aromatics on this. Get a little cigar on the nose, which I love. Give me a little smoky smoke tobacco. I'm in the business. Big red fruit. This is, now, there's the makeup I talk about that like, eh, it looks pretty from afar, but is it really makeup? And then there's the makeup that is like, depends on where you want to take this analogy. There's the makeup of like the ultimate warrior, right? The wrestler. Think Axe and Smash from Demolition. Think the Road Warriors. Think Doink the Clown. There's like so much makeup that it actually becomes good. Like you like the ultimate warrior because it is what it is. Like Kiss, like the band, right? Like it's not trying to trick you. We are here to entertain. And I think a lot of wines are here to entertain. They're bombastic, they're off the charts, they're there for that big steak dinner with your boys, they're there for a Thursday night, I'm gonna watch the Knicks with my guys, because I'm trying to smell the roses a little bit more, my Knick friends, and I'm gonna open up a lot of wine like this. It's big, it's bold, it's delicious, it's a barbecue wine. That's what I get on the nose. Let's see if the body and the taste deliver on that. I'm gonna make this very straight right down the fairway, golf style. Big shout out to AJ, he likes golf now. This is a time and place wine. For me, if I go back to the last wine and I'm at a 3-star Michelin where I'm trying to really pair the wine with the delicate French cuisine and I'm spending a lot of money and I had to wear a jacket and you know I don't wanna do that to get into the place, I'm going with this wine. This wine would overpower the food. And that commitment I made to $700 worth of food, the truffles, the elegance, it would be too overpowering. On the flip side, if I'm drinking, we're in March Madness. If I'm going out to a dinner before I go to the Final Four game or watch it with my buddies, and we're literally having steak and I'm not in the mood for another Cabernet, like I don't want another Silver Oak or Camus or Opus, the Dominus, the cliche stuff they have, and I see this on the list, I'm like, ooh, this has the fruit and the explosiveness to go with steak, but this is Pinot Noir for Cabernet lovers. This is big, over the top, monstrous, and by the way, all of Wall Street down there, they'll love this wine. All of the people that love Super Tuscans and love Bryant family and all that stuff, this is a red wine drinker's dream that knows they love bombastic. As a matter of fact, Dustin, take off your, literally, this is crazy. I cannot believe you wore this. Please take off your headphones and come to the camera. Please do it right now. Yep, there you go. Show them your shirt. Get over here. This is insane that you have this shirt. I don't even remember making this. I do remember. Where'd you find this?
Joao. He
just eats it. It's insane.
Makes sense.
Fruit bomb. This is what I used to call it. The fruit bomb. Thank you. This is a fruit bomb, and this is a time and place wine. This will crush for some people, but for people that are a little more traditional, a little bit more Burgundian, a little bit more like I want Pinot to be Pinot, it wouldn't be. And so I could see very knowledgeable, serious wine drinkers rating this between 87, 88, 88 and 95. It just depends on where you're at. Where I'm at right now is I'm in a good mood. I brought back the show. I'm excited. I don't know if I'm definitely not going 97 points, but to me, excuse me, I'm gonna go 93 points on this wine because it's fun, it's huge, and it's explosive, but it's 93 asterisk. You need to know what you're getting into because it's not for every occasion. Good stuff. What other question do we have before we get off the show?
When opening a premium aged cab, what is the proper decanting technique?
It depends on vintage, it depends on wine, but look, I think wines benefit tremendously from oxygen. The more expensive a wine is, the more decanting or opening the bottle is going to benefit you because big red wines have tannins and there's gonna be a bitterness. Now, as you get really old, you start getting into 20, 30 year bottles, 40 year bottles, sometimes you don't need to decant because the oxygen that's getting through the cork slowly but surely over the 40 years is what's causing what I want you to do on a new wine for 7 or 8 hours. That's how I see it. Any more questions or those to two?
We have a couple.
Give me more.
Which region in Australia is your favorite for wines?
I think Margaret River is my favorite region in Australia because I find them to be the most balanced. I love the Cabernets and the Chardonnays out of the region. But again, just like this Bevan is time and place, if I want bombastic excitement, Barossa Valley makes some of the most explosive Shiraz in the world. And it's funny, I've been talking to Brandon a lot. on winetext.com that all of you should sign up for, because it would mean a lot to my dad. On winetext.com, right now, it's funny to watch the ebbs and flows of what's selling. Right now, Shiraz is not selling as well as it should. We've offered some real monsters, and it does great, but we're on a hot streak right now. Everything's flying and selling out, and like some of the really well-priced, well-scored Shiraz is a little softer, which is fun because I really built my career. I built Wine Library in 98 to 2003 on the back of Australian bombastic wines, because we were the people in America that had the best selection and biggest allocations of the highest and hardest to get Barossa Valley Shirazes that were getting 95 to 100 point Robert Parker scores, which took the industry by storm. So I was in it when Australia was ripping hot. Australia fell off a cliff, so did Spain with those big bombastic wines from Toro, and now they're coming back because they've balanced out a little bit, the hype has calmed down. I like Australian wines a lot. Even the Sauvignon Blancs I think are underrated because New Zealand gets all the pubs. Rieslings are great. Like, there's a lot of good wine from Australia, sometimes overpriced, but Margaret River, Hunter Valley Semillon is something I think is world class, but nobody drinks Semillon yet, but nobody drank Rosé when I was in the prime of my career. So things cycle, and that's how I say it.
This last one from Kay. I'm Just Chris, 1975.
That's I'm Just Chris, 1975, same birth year.
I'm actually 9 months sober, so my question, are there any non-alcoholic wines out there?
That's a great question. The non-alcoholic wine quality thing is just starting. First of all, congrats for being sober, good for you. Keep it going. Number two, I think we're in the early stages. I think in 15 years, people that nerd out about wine, like us three, will be drinking non-alcoholic wine that we think is good, which could seem like sacrilege to people that are the most nerdy, the most stuffy sommeliers, but I see it. I can see there's efforts towards it. It's a viable product. Mocktails are happening. It's in the air, but it's early, and I don't have a recommendation just yet. Please leave a comment in social, on YouTube, or anywhere you watch this. Keep watching the show. Thank you for watching. We keep drinking bad wines so you don't have to. That's the goal really here for me. Let me find wines to tell you not to pick up, but I could be wrong. I could be wrong. Remember the middle of this episode. Find something that matches what you like, but keep trying new things. Challenge yourself to keep trying new wines, new wineries from the things you like. You like La Crema? Go taste another Sonoma or California Pinot you've never had before. Instead of buying a case, buy 6 bottles of this and buy 1 bottle of 6 different Pinots. You might discover your next favorite, and keep trying new things. Keep trying wines that you've never had before. If you've never had Pinot Noir from Oregon before and you're watching and you've been a snobby Burgundian drinker only, well, we've got one for you. So mix it up, try new things, and keep enjoying wine for what it's for, which is the journey. P.S. Real quick, if you have any wine questions, just like you saw in this episode, I will be answering them throughout the next episode. Please leave your wine questions and a team will figure it out and check it out. We'll see you next time.